Tell the person next to you, thank goodness he's finally preaching. Otherwise, we'll never get out of here. Hey, I want to talk about four practices that growing Christians recognize that others don't. Have you ever discovered something like a clue or a key about the universe or about the world or about your life and you're like, man, I wish I knew that a long time ago. Anyone? Like, for instance, I found out recently, I was listening to something on ABC Radio, news radio, and they said that people that are often skinny, this is, and I'm like, okay, yeah, need to listen to this, that they're often the people that they don't do more activity during the day, like more exercise, but they're the people that they, when they're sitting at the table, they're always banging their leg like this or tapping their hands. Or you know those nervous people? Well, I'm one of the, I'm always fidgeting, I'm always tapping, I'm always shaking my leg, and I'm like, man, imagine how big I'd be if I didn't do that. And I thought, I've told a few people, and a couple of people were like, man, I'm going to start just tapping and, you know, getting fidgety because maybe I'll use more energy during the day. Aren't you glad you came to church? And just all sorts of little information that you find out, and you're like, wow, that would have been really helpful to know a few years ago. Well, sometimes I saw this thing on the internet. It was like seven habits of people, of successful people. And you read the habits and you're like, oh, flip, I do one of them. And then you're like, wow, I really wish I didn't read that. You know, it was a BuzzFeed survey or something like that. So today, four practices that growing Christians recognize that others don't. I hope rather than thinking, oh man, I'm not doing these, that you get inspired that these four practices are just things that Christians can do and see and participate in. And it doesn't matter whether you're a really experienced, wise Christian or whether you're just starting out your spiritual quest of following Jesus. You might still be working out whether you are a Christian or not. Doesn't matter. These are four practices that will build growth and momentum in your life and they'll produce good fruit. So I think that's good news. Amen? So the first one is this. Growing Christians recognize that Sundays are a springboard, not a sanctuary, not just a sanctuary. I know a lot of us, we come to church on a Sunday and we're like, oh, I just want to escape the noise and the chaos. I just want to escape my family. I just want to escape my work and I just want to come and listen and be ministered to. And I want to sit on my own and I don't want to talk to a soul. Leave me alone. And I just want, and it's like I go to my happy place and I receive the worship, I receive the ministry of the word and I just, it's like my happy place. And you know, I was chatting with someone in the early service, it was their first time at church. And I said, you know what, your first time, I want you, your first time at church to feel like this is a sanctuary. This is a place where I can be safe. This is a place where I can relax and just feel that God is speaking and ministering to me. But what I notice so much about Christians is if we associate Sunday services as just a sanctuary, it will never be enough because in the Bible that I read, God is my sanctuary, not the church on Sunday. God is my resting place. God is my shelter. God is my comfort. And when I ever, ever, ever in life put trust in jolly people like you to meet all my needs, you always let me down. Always. And I always let you down. And so we have to be really careful about putting our trust in formal gatherings or anything like that because church is wonderful. It's God's idea. Gathering once a week as a corporate large gathering is fantastic. Gathering during the week is fantastic. But it will never be the greatest. It will never satisfy the greatest needs in our life for sanctuary, for home, and for God ministering to us. You know, the greatest picture of church that I've seen in the Bible, and I keep on coming back to it, is Acts chapter 2, verses 46 to 47. Let's read it together. This is a paraphrase from the message. They followed a daily discipline of worship in the temple, followed by meals at home. Every meal was a celebration, exuberant and joyful as they praised God. People in general liked what they saw. And every day their number grew as God added to those who were being saved. The context we know, just if you read a bit earlier, that they were devoting themselves to the apostles' teaching and that they were really grappling with how to unpack the life and the death and the resurrection of Jesus. And they were sharing their possessions, that there was this sense of the rich and the poor gathering together and that no one went without. And so And so that obviously some of them owned homes because they wouldn't have had homes to meet in, but the home owners would open up their homes to people that didn't have homes, and that they would share their possessions, share their wealth, and no one went without. And there was this radiant life that came from the early Christian community. And the thing that amazes me is that it reminds me when I read this text of the importance of corporate gatherings like this. When it says in Hebrews, don't forsake meeting together, I believe that corporate meeting together like this is really important because it forces you to be in a room with people that are very different to yourself politically, economically, socially. And we gather in the name of Jesus. It's very important. These early Christians, they encountered the Lord Jesus, and they were not bound to go to the synagogue. They were not bound to go to the temple, but it says that they how often went to the temple? Daily. Because they were hungry for the Word of God. And at that time, they didn't have the New Testament, so the only Bible they had, except for some letters going around and some oral tradition, was some scrolls that they read out at the temple, like from the Torah, from the Old Testament. And so they were hungry for the Word of God. And so they still went to the synagogue. They still went to the temple, even though they didn't have to, because they were hungry for corporate gathering and to sit under the Word of God proclaimed. And then they would go and they would listen to the apostles teaching them about Jesus and teaching them about what it meant to be people of the Spirit. And then they'd meet in homes. And then they would unpack, connecting the dots between what they'd learned from the Old Testament and the story of Jesus and the apostles' teaching. And they would connect all the dots. And then they would say, what does this look like for our lives? And then they would pray for one another. And then they would eat. And then they would drink. And then they would be merry. And there would be lots of laughter. It says that every meal was a celebration. It was joyful. And it says that the people around them liked what they saw. And every day their number grew. Let me tell you that their number didn't grow because people said, wow, look at these Jews going to synagogue. What they saw is that they weren't just going to synagogue out of a religious duty. They were actually people renewed, revived, and they were meeting together during the week in small groups. And there was a life, there was an energy, there was a love, there was a vulnerability, there was a ministry that was taking place that was rich, that was deep, that was fun. And people said, oh, I want to be part of that. You see, I believe that church is at its best when we come on a Sunday and we say, I am coming to the gathering of God's people, not to go to church, but to be the church. And I'm coming to be the church. I'm coming to participate with my brothers and sisters in ministry. We all have different roles to play. And this Sunday, we are going to be sprung out like a springboard into what God has called us to do in our everyday lives. That we are all going to be a little bit more effective. We're all going to be a little bit more encouraged. We're all going to be a little bit more aware that even though we feel alone on Tuesday morning when we're at work, we're not, because we're part of a bigger family. So Sundays is a springboard for God's ministry and mission to be at work through your life. As soon as you see Sunday as the answer and the apex and the answer to everything about your Christian life, it will lose its vitality. That Sunday is at its best when we recognize it's a gift, it's a springboard. But it's not just a sanctuary that will meet your every needs. A lot of your needs will be met in the quiet place between you and God. A lot of your needs will be met across the table with someone, sharing with them how you're going so that they can speak a word of encouragement into your life, so that they can speak a word of caution into your life. It's very rare that you come to church and someone's going to speak a caution into your life. A bit inappropriate. Someone walks across the room and just says, I've got some harsh words to tell to you. Like, who are you? I've never met you before in my life. Whereas if it's a friend, someone that knows you, and they say, hey, I'm a bit worried about this, or I'm a bit concerned about that, that brings life and health. That's when the church is at its best. You know, the Lochenses, we're very religious around Christmas time. We go to church on Christmas morning, and then my mum, she rules the roost on Christmas lunch. She organises the world's biggest turkey. It's like Mr. Bean's turkey, but bigger. And it's got amazing stuffing. And she, for our whole childhood, she just ran everything. And our goal as children was to stay out of the kitchen. I mean, that was a very clear instruction. Play with your toys and get out of my way. But as we've grown up, slowly, I've been tapped on the shoulder and been like, Tim, you can do the dishes. And in our household, the women do the cooking and the men do the cleaning. After the dinner. If your family's the opposite, if the men do the cooking and the women do the cleaning afterwards, God bless you. But that's not how it works in our family. Otherwise, no one would eat good food. but we scrub. And so my mum, I think she deliberately bakes the turkey in such a way that it makes it impossible to clean. I mean, what is she thinking? And it's just disgusting. Anyway, it takes me longer to clean than it takes her to cook. Anyway, sorry, don't tell mum I'm whinging, please. And anyway, so it's Christmas, but as we've grown, we've taken on more responsibilities. And now that my brother and sister and I, we're married, now our partners are at the table and we are all participating. My lovely wife, Nikki, she'll make something to bring for the lunch. And I will have a very important job. Now that I'm a mature man, it's still to stay out of the kitchen. But I have to keep my children alive and help looking after my nephews and nieces and all that sort of stuff. And we all have a part to play. Imagine if me, an old man of 35, if I rocked up on Christmas Day and I sat in the corner playing with my toys and didn't lift a finger. Do you know what that would do? That would erode the family's harmony. It would erode some of the magic and some of the vibrancy and some of the life. Imagine if my wife did that. Imagine if my sister did that. Imagine with my mum who's recovering from a surgery at the moment. Imagine if she was up there trying to do everything because no one else had stepped up to take their part in the family. Family Christmas is at its best when everyone plays their part. You know what I'm saying? Same in the church. That's when we're at our absolute best. When we take our part, when we recognize that we have to rise up beyond just receiving. Because when I was a kid, Christmas was all about receiving. But now that I'm a parent, I realize it's pretty much all about giving to my kids. And it's all about giving to the family. It's a different mentality. The second one I want to mention is this. Growing Christians recognize the need to practice faith, not just believe it. I think this is really important. Those early Christians, they practiced faith in such a way, the social consequences of faith in caring for widows, caring for orphans, caring for the poor, sharing meals together, being generous, being forgiving, the social aspects of their life looked so different and their behaviors were so different to people that weren't followers of Jesus. Growing Christians recognize the need to practice faith, not just believe it. There's a big difference between just believing something and learning about something and actually doing it. For instance, if you've ever done marriage preparation here at the church, like I remember me when I was doing marriage preparation with our pastor, Nikki and I was a naive little 21-year-old boy. Oh man, I could write a book about what I didn't know back then. And I had marriage preparation. I was a good little naive little virgin 21-year-old. And I remember my pastor just looking at me and just asking me questions and every answer I gave him was wrong. What would you say to your wife if she said this? And I told him the answer and he just goes, oh no. And you know, in marriage preparation, we might discuss conflict resolution. And I've sat down with couples and been like, let's do an exercise in conflict resolution. They look at me like, what are we going to have disagreement on? We haven't had any conflict yet. And I just feel like vomiting. And I'm like, what is this? What kind of relationship is this? There is no conflict. Some of you are like, okay, we don't have conflict and we've been married for 30 years. God bless you. You need to go. Communication. Oh, well, we just communicate about everything. Really? We love to talk till all hours of the night. And I just feel like saying, well, it's not... Come and talk to me in 10 years and see if you want to talk to all hours of the night when you've got kids awake through the night, da da da. It's like marriage preparation. Let's talk about sex. Okay, and that's when the room goes really quiet. And I remember, like, my pastor gave me this book on sex and it was, like, way too graphic for me. And my mind started going, wow, okay, I really don't know what I'm doing. And there's a massive difference between marriage preparation and actual marriage. Can I hear an amen? Like, have you ever done something and you realize, oh man, I read about this or I've been taught about this, but it's really different because now I'm on my own. I need to work out what the heck I'm doing. I think Christianity is a lot like that. We spend a lot of time in Christian preparation. Let's talk about what it means to be a Christian. But then when it comes to actually doing the work of the kingdom, doing the work of the ministry, it's like, let's just go back to church preparation, Christian preparation. Let's talk about it some more. You see, I believe that our beliefs don't just shape our actions. Our beliefs don't just shape our behaviors. I believe that our actions shape our beliefs as well. So what you do and what you experience also shapes the way that you formulate your world. For instance, I asked my daughter the other day about what is the church, because I was preparing for this message. And I said, honey, what's the church? And she goes, it's that place we go on Sundays. I'm like, honey, no, give me some more. And she goes, it's where you work. It's that big building. And then we were here yesterday briefly. And I said, what's the church? And she goes, it's here. It's all around. And I was just, I'm like, Amari, it's not the right answer. The church is not the building. And she goes, yes, it is. Her paradigm of church, her whole life has been this place, this big, massive building where Dad goes a lot. She associates church with programs and with people and with buildings, a sense of space. Whereas where I grew up in this small little church of 30-odd people in the southern suburbs of Sydney. My parents started it with a couple other families. We met in a primary school hall. And my experience of church was this. My experience of church was we could meet in a different venue from week to week depending on where the school kicked us out from. So sometimes the hall was not in use and we had to move to the library, and sometimes we had to move to the media center. That was my experience of church. My experience of church was you get to church an hour and a half early every week. If you get to church an hour early, you're late because we have to set up the chairs and we have to set up the PA and we have to sweep the floor because there's going to be cockroaches on the floor and we can't have church with cockroaches. And my experience of church was being dragged along to these things on Sunday nights called soup and sandwich nights. And I mean, anything about soup and kids, just they don't mix. Like as a kid, you don't want to eat soup. And we go to these soup and sandwich nights and we'd eat soup and we'd have sandwiches and we'd sit there with other kids and the parents would talk for a long, 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 long time and they'd drink coffee and we'd just be like so bored. But for me, that was church, soup, sandwich, connection, sitting across the table from one another. There was, our church had no pastoral care team because there was 30 people. Everyone knew what anyone else was doing. If someone went into hospital, if someone got pregnant or if someone, I don't know, was having difficulties at school. I guarantee you, my mum found out before their own family. It was like everyone knew. Everyone was living in each other's lives. And I look back and I realize that my concept of church was shaped by my experience of church. And I wonder if some of us, we can come to an environment like this and our experience of church can be shaped by sitting in a seat. You can't say that, Tim. You're hurting my feelings. And it's not just you, it's me. We can have a passive mentality. And I believe that growing Christians recognize the need to actually practice some of the faithful practices of what it means to be a Christian. You know where I think that often happens? It can happen through ministries, through youth ministry, through children's ministry, through 1 in 10 that met yesterday. Practices of Christian generosity, caring, love. But I think the primary way it happens is through connect groups. You know, we do have a pastoral care system as a church, a team that does an incredible job visiting people in hospitals and connecting with people that have fallen back and not able to connect on Sundays and not able to connect through connect groups. But let me tell you this, the primary mechanism for caring and loving and sharing and doing life together and actually being an opportunity for people to pray for one another and share and be generous and talk about the word and talk about problems and talk about our families is in connect groups. If you're relying on a church this big, it will fail every time. You will be like a stranger in the crowd. And our connect group leaders are like the frontline pastors that minister. And I love the fact when I hear about our mothers of preschoolers ministry, I hear of so much care that goes on. And it doesn't come centrally necessarily through the church hierarchy. It comes through mums in our church that are caring for other mums. And I love that. I love it. Yesterday when I was looking at a thing on Facebook about a young man in our church that had something not good happen yesterday, and the outpouring from his colleagues and his friends saying, hey, are you all right? Can we come and visit you in hospital? I love that. I love it when I hear about stuff happening and I'm like, wow, isn't it great that care is happening? People aren't waiting for permission. They are just being Christians. Because you don't have to wait for an invitation to be a Christian. You've already got your invitation. It's called Jesus. He said, come and follow me and do the things I've taught you to do. So I think it'd be fantastic for us to pray for our connect groups, because I'm believing this year, whether our connect groups meet fortnightly, monthly, weekly, that we're going to see a growth in groups right across our city, different regions, different areas. And some of you, God might be tapping on the shoulder saying, hey, you know what? I could lead a group in my home. I could host a group in my home. And I don't want to just run a Bible study, but I want to talk about the Word of God. I want to talk about what we learned on Sunday. I want to talk about our prayer life. I want to talk about, hey, how you going? Yeah, awesome. No, you're not. You know what? On a Sunday, if I'm at the door and how you going? And you might not want to have a D&M with me at the door. But when you're in your connect group and someone says, how you going? You know what you can say? I'm actually struggling and I'm not really coping at the moment and I'd appreciate some prayer. That will open up whole new worlds of intimacy in your group. There's certain things that a larger gathering like this just can't do. And I'm believing for an incredible season for our connect groups. They do a great job. It's one of the largest ministries in our church and we want to lift them up as being the primary frontline ministers and carers in our church. And I think it'd be great for us to pray for them. What do you reckon? So can I get all the Connect Group leaders down the front, please? Now. Including young adults, youth, our youth, most of them are upstairs, but come out the front. Why don't you put your hands together, make them feel a bit loved? Pastor Phil, Cass, can you come and lay hands? Move over, stop being humble. All right. Church, why don't we stand to our feet and pray for these Connect Group leaders? Because, and can I just say, can actually everyone turn to me for a sec? I never want to hear, what do you do in the church? Oh, I'm just a Connect Group leader. I never want to hear that. I want to hear things like, I lead a Connect Group and it's an amazing group. Let me tell you about what God's doing. Because you, those dynamics of that, my church that I grew up in, 30-odd people, there's a reason why we were 30 people. There is a reason why we never cracked through 50 or 60 because we were a really dysfunctional group, didn't have strong leadership. But there's a lot of love and there was a lot of activity of the Holy Spirit. A lot of those qualities in my small little church, Menai Church of Christ, you can actually have those qualities of intimacy and love, food, family, laughter, people wanting to join because they want to belong. That can be the qualities that take place in your connect groups every fortnight. And I'm believing for that. And then they can be part of a family and then they can come on a Sunday and say, we are part of a diverse and extended family. And so you guys are on frontline ministers and we just want you to know that you don't need permission. You have been anointed and equipped. Let's pray. Father God, we just pray for every one of these Connect Group leaders now in Jesus' name. We just pray for wisdom, for courage, that they will be groups that grow numerically, but even more important that we pray that they grow in depth, depth of relationship, depth of trust, depth of understanding of the Word of God, that they are safe environments for people to confess and share their struggles and their pain, that they will be places of healing, that they will be places where spiritual gifts can flow, that there will be environments where worship can take place. Lord, we just do also ask for these groups that they will be young and emerging leaders that will rise up within these groups and that they will start and plant and initiate new groups and that there will be great growth taking place. Lord, we believe by faith that what it says in the Scriptures that every day the Lord added to the numbers of those that were being saved. Lord, we just do pray that there are healings, there are salvations, there are people being set free from things that are tying them down and holding them back. Even in these connect groups. So Lord, I just thank you for these people. Lord, refresh them, encourage them. May they realize the incredible dignity and value in what they're doing. And Lord, may you give them fresh vision, fresh fire, fresh passion for the precious people in their group and also for the people that will join. We ask for a blessing upon them, refresh them, fill them, we ask in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. Why don't we put our hands together and just thank these guys. And please take your seat. And after the service, you can see Pastor Janet Bryce at the information desk if you'd like to join a Connect group. Or you could also let us know on your Connect card that's on your chair. So the first practice is growing Christians recognize that Sundays are a springboard, not just a sanctuary. Growing Christians recognize the need to practice faith, not just believe it. Growing Christians recognize that they are ordained for ministry. Now I give you permission, if you want to wear, you know, your priestly collars to church, be my guest. Because in the eyes of the Bible and the early church, that we are all priests. We are all ministers of the gospel. We have different functions and role to play in the church, but we are all ministers. We are all priests. Let's read from 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 4 to 5. As you come to him, the living stone, rejected by humans but chosen by God, the living stone is Jesus Christ, and precious to him, you also, people of God, are like living stones, are being built into a spiritual house. Everyone in this room, you are under construction, that God is actually working, not just in your life, but working us together into a beautiful structure that he calls a spiritual house, to be a holy priesthood. You're not called to be a bricklayer. You're not called to be a teacher. You're not called. Hey, I thought you were at the last service. You love the. I thought the bricklayer reference would be safe, Mick, with you not being here. But you're not, your primary identity is not in what you do. In fact, in the eyes of the kingdom, you're a priest. And what does priests do? They lead the worship. They connect people to God. And they have access to God without having to go through any mediator, because we have a mediator. His name's Jesus Christ. And so it says that we don't have to ask for permission because we're priests. We don't have to wait to go into God's presence because we can go into his presence because of Jesus. Let's read in the message that same passage. Welcome to the living stone, the source of life. The workmen took one and threw it out. They didn't want Jesus, but God the Father set it in the place of honor. Praise God. Present yourselves as building stones for the construction of a sanctuary vibrant with life. I love that. What is God doing? He is constructing us into being a sanctuary. Now, in America, they call church buildings, auditoriums, sanctuaries, okay? So imagine God is building a building, but do you know what he loves? When he thinks of you and I, he doesn't think of us as bricks and mortar. He doesn't think of us as carpet and chairs. He doesn't think of us as a dead building, because let me tell you, I was in here yesterday afternoon and I was walking through this place and there was no one in here and it was absolutely dead. Because do you know where the life comes from? You know where how it becomes a construction, a sanctuary vibrant with life? It's because of you and me. Because we are vibrant with life. And as we are vibrant with life, God is not building a house of bricks and mortar or a house of cards. He is building a vibrant, life-giving sanctuary. We are the temple. We are the church in which you'll serve as holy priests, offering Christ-approved lives up to God. You know, I believe as priests, as ministers of the gospel, we believe by faith that we are ordained. We are set apart to be ministers of the gospel. We don't wait for the pastor. We don't wait for the connect group leader. We don't wait for a piece of paper on the wall. We say, I am a woman of God. I am a man of God. And I'm not perfect, but God's got me here for a reason. And I'm not just here to make up space. Let me tell you, our church, we love gaps between chairs. We just love it so much. And I know, I've seen people come in first time on a Sunday, their first Sunday at church, and they're sitting on their own, and there's someone two rows behind, and they're like, oh, yeah, I'm not sure if they're a new person, so I better not say hello. Might be a bit awkward. I mean, I've only been coming along here for 3.5 years, so I'm still new myself. And there's this mentality that, oh, I'm new or I've got needs. But what I find is if we have that mentality of I'm here to have my needs met, our needs very rarely get met. But our needs are often met when we meet the needs of someone else that has more needs than us. I reckon, Bill Osborne, I reckon you preached something. You said, I'll probably misquote you, I apologize. But I had a lot of brokenness in my life, but I found people that were more broken than me and I was able to help them. In the midst of helping people that are more broken than you, God does a work in your life. So, you, if there's someone sitting a couple rows in front of you, if you're a priest, if you're a minister, just go up and chat with them. It's really easy. Just say, hi, my name's Tim. Do you know anyone here? Hey, do you want some company? Can we sit together? That person, even if you're radically different to them, they will never ever forget you. Because you've taken your part in the body. You know, a church like ours, it's so easy to have a passive mentality. And in the midst of having a passive mentality, we lose the joy, we lose the vibrancy, we lose the richness. I want to be a person that fills the gaps. What in your connect group? What if you're in your ministry, you're going to be the person that fills the gaps. You get there a bit early and you fill the gaps where they need to. If someone doesn't rock up, you fill the gap. If someone has a bad attitude, you fill the gap with a good attitude. If there's a gap in this, if you're looking around and you're saying, hey, I'm not just going to church to receive, I'm going to be the church and I'm going for someone to encourage, you fill the gaps. Last point is this. Growing Christians recognize that they really need the Holy Spirit, or dead religion is inevitable. I've seen the most genuine, loving Christians become spiritually dead. And I've identified it in my own life. Anyone here, do you understand what I mean? Where you notice like a religiosity or a dead, it's like I'm doing Christian things, but the substance and the heart isn't there. Has anyone experienced that in your own life? It's not that you're a bad person. It's called just being a human being. And I think if I was the devil, I wouldn't attack you by necessarily trying to make you into an atheist or make you into a follower of another religion. I would just try to erode your passion, erode your joy, erode your sense of dependence on God. And the thing that always starts our drift is the drift not towards hate, it's the drift towards self. It's the drift towards saying, I actually know some things. I actually know some Bible verses, so don't preach at me, young fella. I was talking to someone, and I've had a conversation with a couple of people, and they've just told me, hey, I know my Bible better than you. And I'm like, well, you might. God bless you. Good luck to you. But you're certainly not living it at the moment. It's not like, are we going to have a contest about who knows the most Bible verses? Is that a sign of spirituality? Growing Christians recognize that they really need God. The first of the Beatitudes in Matthew chapter 5 says, blessed are the poor in spirit. Eugene Peterson says, blessed are those that are spiritually bankrupt. Every day, this is going to be a revelation to some of you, you need all the help you can get to be a good husband. And every day, some of you need all the help you can get to be a good daughter. And you need all the help you can get to not just survive, but to be a godly influence in that jolly, frustrating workplace you're in. And some of you need a lot of help, not just 5 days ago, but a lot of you need help tomorrow morning at 9 a.m. to forgive that person that you really don't feel like forgiving. You need grace, you need mercy, you need help every day to say, God, I feel empty and I need you. That is the key to a growing Christian, to say, God, I need you. God, I need your grace. God, I need your mercy. God, I need your power. God, I need your spirit to give me the ability to do the things that I feel like I can't do today. That's what it means to be a humble but also a growing Christian. 2 Timothy chapter 3, this is a passage that proves to me that we're living in the last days and also proves that we've been living in the last days for 2,000 years. But mark this, there will be terrible times in the last days. Ooh, scary. Okay, people will be lovers of themselves. Tick. Lovers of money. Yep. Boastful. Yep. Proud. Yep. Abusive. Disobedient to their parents. Never. Ungrateful. Unholy. Without love. Unforgiving. Slanderous. Without control. Brutal. Not lovers of the good. This is all signs of a society that's sick, okay? This is signs of a world that's sick. Next one. Treacherous, rash, conceited, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God, having a form of godliness but denying its power, have nothing to do with such people. You see, that's what I want to finish on. If you want to be a growing Christian, you need to be very careful if you've got the form of godliness, the form of religion. You go to church, you go to Connect Group, but the substance that fills the form, the heart behind the religion is vacant. And that is where Jesus, when he did his ministry, he would look at the form, he would look at the substance, he would look at the religious frillings, and he would just say, how's your heart? Where's your passion? What do you love? What are you giving your life for? What are you worshiping? Three things that we can do to make sure that we don't just have a form of godliness, but we actually live godly lives. We drink, we feed, and we confess. I think every day, get up in the morning and say, I need to drink of your spirit, God. What does that mean? I think it means in prayer, in worship. What does it mean? It means to pray, not just to get to the end of the prayer, but pray until you have a sense of God's presence in your life. But some mornings you get up and you feel pretty unholy. Until you get that morning coffee, you say a lot of unholy things too. Pray until you have a sense of God's presence is with me. He's with you, but you drink of his spirit. Jesus said, I'll give you living water and you'll never be thirsty. You drink, you put a worship song in the car. You do something, you go for a walk and you say, I want to experience your presence. I don't want to just know about it. I want to drink from your spirit. Feed from the word. Just open the scriptures and just read it until you feel like there's been a nourishment in your heart and a nourishment in your mind, that you've grown, that you've changed the way you think. It can be one verse or it can be three chapters. It doesn't matter. We drink from the Spirit, we feed from the Word, and we confess. And I think every day, whether you're in a connect group or whether you're on your own, you need to just confess where you've fallen. Confess where you're not there. But also confess the goodness of God. Also confess the victory of God. Confess that even though you sinned yesterday, you are not defined by that sin. And as far as the east is from the west, that's how far he's removed your sin from your transgression from you. That you are a new creation in Christ. The old has gone and the new has come. That greater is he that is in us than he that is in the world. And so when you confess your sin, you also confess the victory and the hope and the purposes of God. So you start the day thinking, I don't have much to give God, but because of who Jesus is and what he's done, I have something to give today. And that helps us from being hollow religious people, but filled with purpose and power.